Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Welcome again to this segment of the Oregon Voters Digest. I'm Bruce Broussard, your host, and we're going to have quite a show today. And unfortunately, it is Easter Sunday.
Yeah.
Some people celebrate Easter Sundays. Others don't celebrate Easter Sunday. We do know about the eggs. I think he ran out of eggs at Safeway or something. but the bottom line is that we're doing the show today, but we do want to wish you all a happy Easter. And for those of you who don't necessarily celebrate that, we just say, I hope you had a good day today. Because, our days are pretty stressful nowadays, and a lot of things are happening within our communities around the state. And so, but what we got here today is that we got three guests with me today that their community, and also we also have a visitor within our ranks, someone that's newly here. We want to welcome him to Portland, Oregon. And I'm talking about Dr. Ryan Petteway. He happens to be the assistant professor of OHSU PSU School of Public Health. I want to welcome you to Portland, Oregon.
Thanks.
All right, I want to make sure you understand that.
Yeah. Okay. Sure, thank you.
All right. And he happens to be a co-host, if you will, I guess one of the co-sponsors of this particular event called Gun Violence as a Public Health Issue Community Forum. Now, that may sound sophisticated, but in all due respect, through this hour, we're gonna define what it means to you. And I've got two reputable community folks here in the Portland metropolitan area who's been around here for quite some time. They work very, very hard, very dedicated, if you will, to community. Even though, regardless how stressful it is, they tend to just set it aside and they're just constantly still here. And I think that's why I'm still here to a certain degree. But the bottom line is that I'm talking about Cynthia Harris. She was one of the, as far as I'm concerned, one of the well-known person who worked very hard at Jefferson High School. In most cases, the viewing audience would know that Jefferson High School, the perception was that it was a predominantly African-American public school in any high school, whatever. But in all due respect, it's very, very diversified. In fact, it's even more diversified today. Mm-hmm. I mean, as opposed to when Mrs. Harris was there. If anybody has any background on our youth today, she has a legacy along that line. We want to welcome you. Thank you. And thank you for all the hard work you've been doing.
Thank you.
And keep on doing it, Cynthia.
Oh, keep on doing it.
Keep on doing it. And then we got this gentleman by the name of Royal Harris. I just happened to have met Royal to Eugene Richard. He was already there anyway. He knew me before I knew him. Mm-hmm. But to a certain degree, I knew of the activities, if you will. And he brings quite a wealth of information. I want to thank you, Royal, for all the work that you've done here within the community. And around the state, off the bat, you've been a good communicator, if you will, to the majority community on the other side of the river. And there's a major need for such. And you've been doing this for a number of years. And like Eugene Richard, in the same boat down at Multnomah County, as you know, mm-hmm. You guys have really been very much involved. And so as a result, I want to thank you very much for all the hard work you've done.
Well, thank you for what you do, and thank you for having me here.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you for being here. Well, okay. Well, like I said, what this is going to be, folks, is going to be basically about this particular event that's going to be on Saturday, April the 22nd, from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. at Highland Christian Center, right, 7600 Northeast Gleason Street, Portland, Oregon. I'm sure everyone knows the Reverend Hardy. Reverend Hardy is a well-known gentleman, and in fact, he's got probably the largest church, predominantly African-American church here within the city of Portland.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, very much so, yes, very much so. You got some very interesting guys. You got Ken Berries, you got all of them. There are a whole bunch of young folks that are sitting over there. Really good, very progressive.
I went there for about 4 years. I didn't know it was the largest. Good.
So this event's going to, again, like I said, it's going to be held on Northeast Gleason, 7600 Northeast Gleason Street. And that's this Saturday coming up from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. And trust me, you need to be there. And it's a very diverse subject because it's across the board. This is not just, quote, African-American issues. It's an issue with a number of our youth. And now it's kind of like peering into our adult arena. But the whole idea of gun violence as a public health issue forum, you know, the association of gun violence, and is it a healthy issue? Or is it just a gun issue with all of the issues of whatever? But then we're going to learn a lot of things. And so we're going to have this discussion, and we're joining you now, and we want you to show the importance. We can't give you the entire event, if you will, within an hour's piece, but we have at least some input, and to a certain degree, we got one of the co-sponsors, a co-host, if you will, of that particular event. Co-coordinator, right. So consequently, we're sharing with him what we feel are some of the needs that should be discussed in part of the presentation. Is that fair?
Yeah.
Okay. So why don't we start off with just a little background on each of you. We'll start with you, Doctor, and then you just kind of share with them your background, your educational background, how you got to Portland, and the kind of work that you're doing now, and you're just leading up to that aspect of it, okay?
Yeah, sounds good.
Good.
Try to be brief, I guess. So I'm brand new to Portland. I've only been here since August. Moved up here to take the job at Portland State in the OHSU PSU School of Public Health. And I have to be honest saying that, you know, Portland was never really on my radar for, you know, cities that I would, I would move to and, you know, work in. Coming from the East Coast, mostly Pittsburgh, and my dad's family from Detroit, Toledo area, living and working in Baltimore. But I think when I decided I wanted to do my doctorate program, at the time I was working at Baltimore City Health Department, and I decided I needed to see something different. So my work as a social epidemiologist, I study what's called the social determinants of health. And so instead of looking at health outcomes and diseases and sickness and things like a victim of gun violence, I'm looking further upstream at the social, political, economic causes of these outcomes, right? And so I did a lot of that work in Baltimore, but my perspective and my lens from that, from my background, was really from a Midwest, East Coast perspective. And as I joke with people, when I first moved out to Oakland, when I decided to go to Berkeley to do my doctorate, you know, one of the projects I was working on was in a community that was known to be a rough community. But from my eyes, I'm looking around seeing that these houses had grass and they had palm trees. And so even though that was a rough neighborhood, from my outside perspective, it was different, right? It was completely different from walking around in like Detroit or in Pittsburgh, Baltimore, right? And so I think that one of the things that brought me initially to the West Coast was I needed to get a new perspective on the things that I study, particularly because I study neighborhoods and health, place and health. So looking at the things that are in neighborhoods or not in neighborhoods that either create positive health opportunities or create health risk within the places where people live, learn, work, and play. And so, you know, that perspective I had on that was really, you know, it was really kind of, you know, it wasn't very nuanced, very dynamic, being only in those cities and those areas. So moving to the Bay, going to Berkeley to my doctorate really helped me see a different part of how you can approach place and understand place and how place shapes health. Particularly like this forum is going to discuss in the context of gun violence and the things that within neighborhood context, community context, that shape risk and opportunities. And so I think that from there, you know, did a doctorate at Berkeley and, you know, of course had to find a job and get paid. You know, don't get the doctorate and go home sleep on the mom's couch anymore. Yeah, you know? And so, you know, I'm looking for job opportunities, and I saw something open up at Portland State, and the ethos and the vibe that they had there is very much social justice oriented, social determinants oriented. Mm-hmm. And so that appealed to me. But of course, I had heard, you know, stories about the history of the state of Oregon as a history person, and of course, the city of Portland, and some of the things that for me I thought would compromise my ability to effectively work on the issues that I wanted to work with and the communities I wanted to work with, right? But I came up here, met people, they made me feel comfortable. And so I'm here. Okay. And so awesome. This is one of the first things I got involved in, and I'm looking forward to really learning more about Portland, first of all. Royo and Cynthia, been here for a long time. They have a lot of knowledge, and for me, I'm really brand new here. And so getting involved in this was a challenge because I felt like maybe I needed to learn a little bit more before I engage. But I think that this process.
Well, in all due respect, what we'll do is that you talked about this Portland area, the vision of what Portland was, how you were introduced to Portland, and what it meant to you, or what it was being seen by you, whatever. I'm just going to let these two folks here that we've been involved just kind of share with you.
Okay.
That it may be looked upon outside of Portland as the whitest city in the state of Oregon, or the whitest area in Oregon, whatever. But we do have some black folks here. we do have some black folks here. And here, we're here. We're here. We're surviving. We're eating every day.
Yeah.
We're dealing with issues.
Barely, but
and
we're
doing diverse it. Issues. But we're very sensitive and very concerned about the African American community, mm-hmm. but about the community as a whole, because we have to deal with it. Because we are in a minority, in all due respect. In fact, the brown side of the so-called definition of minority is far more progressive than we are. And so it's a constant struggle, but we're here.
Yeah.
Fair?
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm just going to let them reflect a little bit. In fact, we'll start off with Cynthia.
Are you going to go with me?
Yeah, well, yeah, your time at Jefferson High School. What do you think about?
I will also go back to my time in Oakland.
Yeah, sure. Okay.
So I'm a Bay Area person. I was born in San Francisco. I worked in the Oakland schools for 25 years and did a lot of community work with the 100 Black Men in the Bay Area. A lot of organizations. It was just so much. That's where my real heart came. Mm-hmm. And I was recruited to come to Oregon. So I think 10 years ago is very different from how it is today. Many of us have taken our beatings and plowed the ground, but we're still standing. So I came here as area superintendent, stayed for 3 years, did really well. I ran into heat in my fourth year as the transition. I did a lot of observation, a lot of work, and I made my major moves in the fourth year, and that's when I ran into a lot of trouble. But the good news is the school is still standing, and it's elevated because of the hard work I did on the ground. So I'm excited about that. What I do now is I work with my own company, Hatch Coaching and Events, and I do some work with the Happiness Foundation as a director of success. So I'm working with issues of people with their success stories and how they're doing and the technology they're working on through the Church of Scientology. I work with them on moving issues that can't be moved in their emotional life. So, you know, like courses on ups and downs and things like that. So I do that. And I'm an outgoing second VP for the NAACP. So we invite both of you to join that. We do a lot of justice work.
What was your definition 10 years ago? What was your
definition? Well, when I came in, I came in with heat because
heat.
If you come
mean?
In, well, I think that the normal people that were African American were more suppressed, I would say. And I came in with a voice. I came from Oakland. I mean, we turn the world around. We work with speed. We make things happen. And, you know, I came with that, and I wasn't silent. I wasn't quiet. The first thing I did was look at all the budgets and see what things that weren't working well, and was given with Vicky the go-ahead. And as I did those things, I learned that change is not a three-year program process. It's a 10-year process because you have things that have been rooted in this area for a long time, and that's race relation, how the dollars were spent. I was really concerned. I had 32 schools, and my hardest school, of course, were the schools in the Northwest, and Jefferson being the toughest and the filthiest. I was concerned about those students, and, you know, so I wanted to know how the money was spent. So that was my very first task, and I don't know. Money is spent really different in the Portland schools. It was spent centrally, and the principal was basically a figurehead, so I was trying to turn some of those things
around. But you were assigned to Portland, to Jefferson High School.
No, I wasn't really assigned to Jefferson. I was area superintendent, and that was one of my schools. I had 32
But
schools.
I mean, when Vicky left, you
when
went
Vicky
to Jefferson.
Left, she asked me, because the principal that was there left, would I help? But I still have my other title.
Okay, well,
for a great amount
I'm just
of
thinking
time.
About those students, you know.
Yeah.
You know, I'd like to get your feel or sense, if
yeah.
you will.
But
what did
I
you think about those students down there?
I think they've come a long ways, and I've come a long ways. I think they were very suppressed. And what turned the day for those students was when Tom Potter, who was the mayor of the city, came to the school and put his office in that school for 3 weeks. That made everything change. So I think
he was the mayor.
He was the mayor at the time.
And former chief of police.
Chief of police. And I, you know, I say to this day, you know, that changed, you know, he heard what I was doing, what I was trying to do, and he just came and helped.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So with that being said, I think that today I'm just like working on justice issues, and I have much quieter presence. I think when you deal with heat and you get through it, you just want to step away from it for a while.
Okay.
And so I still work with the NAACP, and I dress for success and things like that.
Okay. Royal, you got to bring it in now, bro.
Hey, I'm the only native Oregonian up
yes,
here.
There you go. There
so.
You go.
And it's interesting listening. I'm like, okay, 10 years, couple of months.
Yes.
And as a native Oregonian, I always like to dispel a couple of, first myth I always want to dispel. By living in the whitest city in America, per se, we still have the same kind of injustice that people living in the blackest city have.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes that misnomer of looking at the larger segment without looking at a racism, oppression, violence, we have it proportional to who we are.
Mm-hmm.
I think sometimes as people who come here because we have this very unique, very white state, they think to a certain degree we're suppressed or some of this. And I think what really doesn't get shown as much is because of the institutional nature of how African-American population in Oregon was targeted.
Mm-hmm.
We have a very young population. Even if you look at Oakland, there's a certain level of maturity
That's
to
true.
That population.
Mm-hmm.
We always tell people, Portland has the sense of always being that city that's like just a little more than adolescent, maybe that late 20s, early 30s, trying to measure up to those older groups. Or like Ryan, for example, coming from Detroit or Baltimore, where you have African-American communities that are over 150 years old, mm-hmm. where ours really only dates back to the, as a really vibrant culture, back to the 40s. So we're still relatively young. And I think we're still having those growing pains and then trying to find identity mm-hmm. with a lot of those dynamic issues that everybody has. So it was funny because I was listening to her story of Jefferson, and I always think back to when I was in school and I had friends going to Jefferson who were going to Northwestern or Howard or Berkeley. So for me, I think as we talk about Jefferson or as we talk about those things, I think the success has been there. I think we have those pockets where there's a disconnect. So that, and especially in African-American communities where oral history or shared or passed down history is vital to succession planning, we've had those breaks, whether it's due to gun violence and the increase in African-American violence, whether it's due to drugs, whether it's economic hardship, whether it's gentrification. These are all from a native, things that create those gaps that don't allow us that cohesive transfer of knowledge that we can share so that we don't reinvent the wheel, or just importantly, readdress some of the same ills. So like for me, I've spent most of my life working in Northeast Portland, working in mental health, working with at-risk youth, working in the community. And so even now I'll be starting a new position with Multnomah County with the Healthy Birth Initiative as their male and father involvement program coordinator. And it's really looking at how do we institutionalize, memorialize things that allow us to create community-wide succession plans, whether it's institutional, whether it's through opportunities such as Ryan has to create events in the community that start the dialogue, that create those networks and pathways, whether it's things like this TV show that allow us to get this message to a broad spectrum audience, mm-hmm. and really looking at that. I think too often, as we look at some of these issues, or as we look at Portland and we look at all the deficits, we have a lot of assets. And one of the things I unapologetically say is, as African Americans in Portland and including our African community, because I think too often as we look at the Portland of the future, and especially as we look at our young people in violence and where they're getting their understanding of violence from, as we have immigrants and refugees coming in with their narratives, are we making sure that we're inclusive of them? Mm-hmm. And I always go back to, it's not enough black people in Oregon to scare white people. Mm-hmm. But there are mm-hmm. enough that if we mm-hmm. mobilize and work together in yeah. efficient ways, mm-hmm. we can create the things that give us the quality of mm-hmm. life we want. And I think as we do that, we have to always be cognizant and aware of the fact that it's a process. And like a lot of folks have always said, if you really want to see growth, understand once you plant the seeds for a tree, you might not ever see the shade.
That's mm-hmm. right.
The key is, do you plant and fertilize until it's time for you to let pass it off to someone else?
You know, I might add, and just a little side note on my end of it, I came to Portland, Oregon back in 68, right from Vietnam, wow. as a Marine recruiter, which was very unique. I had a uniform. So consequently, I immediately got to the table. Wow. I think twice about if I had I not had that uniform, I probably wouldn't be sitting here today, because mm-hmm. I had other opportunities in Texas and things of that nature. But the fact of the matter is, I came here as a recruiter, and that was very unique because I was introduced to the community from the standpoint because I happened to be an African American, and then I knew basically the lay of the land, and I knew that there were opportunities, if you will, to get young people out of the criminal justice system. And I used my recruiting along that line. I worked very closely with JDH. I worked all over Southeast Portland. I worked all over the place. But I specifically wanted to put an office up in Northeast Portland. Wow. And to focus on individuals that were in the criminal justice system, because at that time there was an expungement kind of a program. So meaning that if you go into the service, you spend 2 years, you just totally get rid of your background, this and that, and you have an opportunity. And I feel so proud of it today, because during that particular period, I see young people today, some have retired, you know, some of them it just changed their whole life, if you will. And so it forced me to get into the community and deal with the young people. And in fact, I even put together an office on the corner of Shaver and MLK, where those murals are. That was my office. I put the only recruiting station in the state of Oregon. There's never been one like that since I left. But the whole idea, I wanted it to be there, to physically work with folks, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then, the long story at all, I just want to kind of give you a feel of the things that I've done. I used to own the Portland Observer newspaper. It's a black-owned newspaper, but it was a good newspaper. And then we got into some major issues like the Possum incident. We did housing. I got into the housing business. I built a senior citizen complex here in Portland. Would like to have done more of that and tried to get into the housing thing because that's another major part. Black folks are pretty well, you can rent, but you can't buy. And so we put together a program to own home. I basically used my credit. I used my credit to buy the home and then sell it on a lease option purchase to an African-American who didn't, and basically it was a basic deal. We tend to recognize first month, last month, and cleaning deposit. That was the down payment to get into a house. And I'm kind of proud to say that I see folks now today that my wife and I, we were able to afford them an opportunity to own their own home. And so not bragging or whatever, but I'm just saying I was just forced to do that because that's what I had when I came here. And rather than leave, I just stayed here and tried to build. And so you meet folks like Royal, yourself, Eugene, and you know, they're just on down the line. And so I'm kind of like part of the deal. And as Roy was saying, it looks like once you get in it, you stay in it because there's not many of us. And you don't have the opportunity to relax, but you can't. You got to eat. You still got to eat.
Yeah.
And then whenever you get into this kind of business, it's harder to eat. But it keeps you moving and whatever. And, you know, I'm sitting here approaching 80 years old now.
Wow.
And I feel like I'm about, just about 2 years younger than Royal now. But, but anyway, in terms of a mindset aspect of it. And that makes me feel good to know that I know Royal and we communicate whenever. And I know
I'm happy to hear that.
And folks like
I'm
that.
Happy for this connection.
Yes, and then he's getting ready to go to Multnomah County. Eugene's already down there, aspect of it. I've been trying to get him to come on the show and do a host, but now I know he's going to be able to do it. Now he's got the Voters Digest, so he's going to be able to, he's going to be a co-host doing what he's doing.
I think that's great.
And give that a little bit. And maybe yourself, you're about ready to go anyway too.
Yeah.
So that gives you. I thought maybe it would be a good time to just give you a little overview of some of the things that we're doing. And you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, I appreciate it. It was good. I think that these conversations are the conversations that I'm hoping to have more of. Hopefully by now I would have had more of these conversations, but you know. Slowly.
Well, hey.
I think the Mr. Dixon over at Jefferson told me, is when you walk into a dark room, you gotta let your eyes adjust. Otherwise, you go around stubbing your toe.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm trying not to stub my toe. I'm trying to take my time and make make those connections.
Well, you got that career. You're a PhD. You've gone through that. You've gone through that process. That's a good example of some of the youth that are looking at you and Cynthia and Royal and whatever. And it's very important that we share that with our youth because that's kind of like part and parcel of what we're talking about. See, gun violence is sitting there. We got, everybody has the gun. We got the concealed weapons. We got all kinds of things. And so, as a lay person from my standpoint, how do you deal with that? And then now you're making the point. It's a public health issue.
Yep.
So you are a very valuable commodity, introducing it to the table. So as time goes, we want to entice you to stick around here. This is not just a step off point. We're going to keep you around.
Yeah.
So anything you need from us, and IE, and want to share your progress, please come over here on the Oregon Voters Digest and share it with the public at large because the majority of the community need it just as well as the African American community. Fair?
Yeah.
Okay. It's okay. Why don't you say, I tell you what, let's start off by basically saying, let's talk a little bit about this forum itself. You know, what do you think? Well, why are you doing this forum? What was it for again?
Yeah, you know, why? Like, why not? It's I think it's long overdue. I think that most folks, not just in Portland, not just in Oregon, I think most communities across the country would argue that it's about time. It's been beyond time. So I think that now, you know, specifically for this forum, you know, I think that the work got really going on this last summer. President of OHSU, Dr. Joe Robinson, really wanted to, you know, bring OHSU and PSU the resources to the table to really do something about this from a public health perspective. And I think that, you know, the events over the last, you know, 3 to 4 years especially, though we know our history, it goes back way before that in terms of issues of gun violence, whether it's interpersonal community violence, whether or not it's drug or gang related or not, whether it's police-involved shootings, whether it's intimate partner violence, domestic violence. This issue has been around for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
But public health as an institution has been kind of curiously absent from that. So much injury and trauma and stress, emotional and physical damage and loss of life in the history of gun violence. And public health has really not been at the table, and I think that OHSU and PSU wanted to, you know, to be one of those first institutions to bring those resources to the table and collaborate. And I think that for me, being new here, and kind of just getting settled in my office, and I heard about that, and I'm not gonna lie, I was kind of surprised, because I always argue that health is probably the most political thing ever, I'd spar toe to toe with anybody who wants to disagree with that. I think that health is one of the most political things, and within that umbrella of health, I would say that gun violence is probably one of the most politicized within that. And so for an institution like OHSU and PSU and the School of Public Health to say, hey, you know what, we realize these conversations are going to be very divisive. There's going to be people that love this conversation, and there's people going to hate this conversation. But regardless of that, they were willing to really commit and take that risk and take that stand. And I think that's something that I would hope and think that the Portland community and the state of Oregon would really appreciate. And I think that, you know, the initiative behind this event is really just open this conversation, let's get it going. It's long overdue. And so I think this particular forum is the second forum. The first forum was in January. And that was really getting with the internal community at the two institutions to really kind of see how things are going within the campus community in terms of, you know, what's the police presence like and security on campus? What are the incidents of racial bias and discrimination on campus? What are safety concerns? What are other violence concerns within the campus community? And then how can those two institutions figure out how they can leverage and collaborate to make a broader impact beyond the campus, right? So this idea of coming off the hill finally, which for me, it's nice to see coming from Baltimore, where there's institutions there that, you know, they let things go on in their backyards and don't really step up too much to the challenge, right? So I think that for me, I was excited. Like I said, I was just, you know, I didn't even have lamps in my office yet, but I heard about this is going on. I was like, you know what, you know, let me see if I can contribute something here. And so I think that, I think it's long overdue. And so this event right here will be the second event, and I think it's the what I hope will be a starting point for a longer-term conversation and longer-term action.
Okay. I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll go around the rooms. Like I say, these folks have been out there in the community quite a bit, and you got our form. You got your format pretty well laid out. Let's see if we can get just a little input from them in terms of how they reacted to that first point that you made in regards to what are the impacts of gun violence of our community as we see it. And we realize we got this forum coming up, but just give them some input so we can I get these folks motivated to be at this. I see where you're coming from. What do you think?
You want me to go?
Okay.
So I'm personally a nonviolent person, so I don't own a gun, but there was a gun in my house that I never knew about. So when my dad died, my mother gave it to me. And it's just like, what am I going to do with this? And so I turned it in. I didn't want it. So, but in the room where I used to sleep at my mother's house, there was a bullet hole. And so somebody had passed the house and shot into the house. So there was a lot of gun violence in the area of Richmond where my mother lived. And so I saw how detrimental it was. And when I was principal at Nystrom in Richmond, some of the students had died with gun violence. There was a death also at Jefferson when I was there too from gun violence. A girl died. So I know that it's something that has to be a deal with, but I just really believe it goes so far before you get to the gun. It's how the people, I just think it's parent involvement, it's community engagement, it's the activities that our students don't have, it's how we behave, it's how we talk to people, it's how we love or not love. It's so many things to me. And so I'm shifting my day so I could go to here. I want to listen, because I don't think I'm a good person to really talk about this, because I was never spanked as a child. I was always a good person. Jobs have been given to me. I just don't have a lot of anger. I just think there's a lot of anger when I talk to people. I can just see it in them. And I would just like to know sometime, like, where does that come from? Like, is it really coming from racism? Is it really coming from the home? Is it coming from the schools? Like, what are those issues beyond the gun that make people act the way they act?
How did Portland Public School dealt with gun violence?
I don't know that they really had a dealing with gun violence. I don't think we definitely, when I was, you know, it's been 7 years now, it's almost 10 years. I didn't realize any really conversations around this. I don't even know that I had any conversations around this with the students.
I'm thinking about shootings, you know what I mean? As far as kids are concerned, kids bringing maybe guns to school.
Well, you know, we know it's, you just can't, you can't do that. But the guns were happening more out in the streets with the gangs. And with the, they weren't inside of the space. But I don't even think we were having like real good conversations around this in those you know, like 8 years ago. Okay. We weren't having these kind of conversations. This is a really step up, you know, in terms of OSCSU coming together, the gang task force. They've been pushing this at the gang task force. They're pushing it with the clergy. They're pushing it with everybody. So I really rearranged my day so I could attend, you know, because NAACP is meeting at the same time. There are a lot of people meeting at the same time.
Okay.
So I'm wanting to hear what people have to say about this. You know, I just think as an educator, because I've been an educator all of my life. I was in West Oakland. So I've been in a lot of, I've chose these kinds of communities to work in. And so guns have been around a long time. I remember parents dying in West Oakland, like in the late 70s and early 80s. So
so you see this as a value for the education community
from the
for to
the
attend this particular.
Yeah, okay. I think people should definitely put this in their day, especially our psychologists in the community, clergy, business people, and parents should come out.
Good. Tell you what we'll do. We're going to take a short break before we get Roy, because I really want him to spend some time and kind of get a sense of what's happening on the streets.
Yeah, he would know more than
and
me.
And also police and this, that, and the other, because he's been in a lot of these dialogues and whatever. We're going to take a short break, folks, and we'll be right back with you.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend.
Okay. I guess we're back again. All right. Again, we're talking about OHSU, PSU, gun violence as a public health issue within the Portland metropolitan community. If you missed the first half of the show, I would suggest that you get the repeat. You can get on YouTube, and there's replay times and aspect of it. But again, we're just going to get right back into the discussion where we left off. And we were sort of getting some input from community. And Cynthia Harris kind of talked a little bit about the education community, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And then now we're going to have Royal. Royal, he's the man of the street. He's been around, and he's been on and on and on. Come on, Royal, give it to us.
Well, first, as I think about this, and I look at addressing gun violence, I think my biggest hope is that we don't look at this solely from a news embellishment standpoint.
Mm-hmm.
I think we have to realize, and especially as African Americans, because we can all speak to the tragedies in communities ravaged by gun violence. But I think if we want to talk about gun violence, we have to take that step back and first accept every fundamental piece of American culture is based on gun culture. Whether it's the Revolutionary War, whether it's the Civil War, whether it's the war, we're a country that has been at some form of use of violence through gunpowder and metal for over 240 years. So I think to a degree, as we as African Americans talk about this, there's a certain semblance of guilty ownership we take of gun violence. That is something that if we really want to address it, we have to stop, because I don't care if you've never been in trouble, you went to church every day, you go to work all the time, you didn't watch a Dirty Harry movie, you didn't watch Men in Black, you watch Gunsmoke, you watch something where as part of American culture for conflict resolution, we use weapons and violence. It goes back to the Lone Ranger shot people, and he was the good guy. So as we look at gun violence, we have to separate pathologizing the individuals or that image and really look at, okay, what's the culture and why would they do that? As we look at our young people, with African-American young people, the issue of gun violence, I always, and as Dr. and I were talking about, goes back to the issue of poor inability to resolve conflict. One of the things I always say is, you can determine how likely a child will be for violence by looking at how many words they know by the time they hit elementary school or kindergarten. Because if I can't articulate my pain, I express my pain. If I can't articulate my frustration, I express it. If I can't articulate being devalued or dehumanized, I express it. So with a lot of our young people, or with a lot of adults, because let's be honest, youth gun violence makes us feel sad.
What?
Makes us feel sad. We okay. Like the young man who died at Holiday Park. We all grieve for him, and rightly so. But do we show that same concern when it's adult gun violence? It becomes an issue of personal responsibility. Mm-hmm. It's not of community responsibility. And I think speaking to that, as the doctor and I talked about, there's always this dance between looking at gun violence as a public health issue vis-a-vis looking at to the safety of our ability to live fulfilling, enriched lives to our meaning, or is it a public safety issue, which is a detriment to our ability to freely navigate and feel safe in our own communities? Okay. And too often, we do it in this binary either or, when they both go on a continuum. One of the things I like to say, I truly believe, public health defines problems, looks at root causes, and comes with solutions. Mm-hmm. Public safety measures the outcomes to see if it's right or wrong. Because if we use public safety to drive reducing gun violence, we either suppress or we demonize, which really doesn't go back to those root causes that gave somebody that as a hope, whether it could be all the things I mentioned about inadequacies, whether it's economic inadequacy, housing inadequacy, a belief in hopelessness, the imagery that portrays young people of all colors, especially those in black and brown, that violence is a problem-solving issue, that violence is a revenue-generating issue, that violence is an affirmation to show your manhood, or for a lot of young ladies, to show a disformed womanhood right now. So I think as we look at this, I think one of the things I want to go back to is what we call, one of the title of this event, Transforming Pain into Power. Because ouch pretty much generally precedes any time you hit somebody, whether it's an emotional pain or a physical pain. Generally, your response is to equal or greater extent. So we have to transform that. And I think as we look at it.
Yeah. But you know that violence, Pete, just real quick, we'll get this other point. Back in my day, in the 50s, in the early 50s and whatever, it was, and I went through that transition, it was the fist.
Yeah.
We just fought, that was the violence. Then it went from the fist to the knife.
And yep, I'm talking about the knife, yeah.
And then now it's the gun.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I mean? That's that historical piece.
Yeah.
And we never had that in our mindset from the standpoint of killing anyone. And then I'm thinking about it, I'm trying to associate that with the health aspect of it.
Yeah.
You know, you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I think that, you know, one of the, again, like I said, health is political. I think gun violence is one of those particularly politicized and really deeply embedded and ingrained elements of living in the U.S., right? And so I think that there's, you know, the story you just told, there's elements of so many levels of structure. And as Roy and I were discussing, I really, for gun violence for me, putting in the context of structural violence. And so thinking about the ways that opportunities regarding life in general, but particularly health, are structured by policies and systems and practices that basically limit what's available to certain populations versus other populations, right? And you put that in historical context and you think about the ways where how education opportunities have been structured over generations, housing opportunities have been structured over generations, and you see this context right now in Portland with displacement and gentrification going on.
Yep.
After a history where these same neighborhoods were racially restricted covenants dominated and they were redlined in zones so African Americans and Latinos couldn't live in these neighborhoods. These same neighborhoods are now, those communities are now being displaced as people try to reclaim those spaces, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you have these structural forces that destabilize communities, that inflict trauma and damage, emotional, psychological damage on people. And I think that, you know, this theme, Transforming Pain to Power, is really trying to acknowledge what Roy was getting at, is that a lot of times when we're talking about violence, there's a hurt person.
Mm-hmm. I agree with that. Mm-hmm.
In response to their hurt and their pain by processing those emotions and turning and hurting either themselves or hurting another individual. And so I think that when you think about the context of the structural history of policies and practices within Oregon and the city of Portland, and then you have the larger narrative that goes way beyond just Oregon of this history of this the culture of violence in the U.S. in general. It bleeds into everything, from back in the war on drugs and the war on poverty to now you have commercials on the war on cancer, or you have athletic teams wearing camouflage when they go and play a sport. They're playing a game and they're wearing camouflage. So we put violence into everything in our culture. And so I think when you look about this, look at this on these larger, you kind of zoom out and get away from blaming individuals for what they're doing. on a community level, within their households, intimate partner violence. If we could stop blaming individuals for damage that was done to them and their families over generations, and if we could stop doing that, then I think we can really make some strides to understand how we can move forward through healing. And I think that's what we're trying to capture this theme here, transforming pain and power, is that in order to address gun violence on a large level, you have to have whole people.
Yeah.
And you have to have hope.
That's good.
You can't get to being whole and having hope without healing first.
Mm-hmm.
And so we can figure out a way to collaboratively work with communities, academics, community-based organizations, community individuals, and figure out how we can come together and start this process. Then I think that there's a real opportunity to really actually make some real strides here. And that goes for the spectrum of gun violence too.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, for us, as the media portrays a lot of times, that we think about gun violence as being something between teenagers and low-income people in the projects and movies and gangs and everything like that. But in the state of Oregon, as I mentioned before, it's a different context. Most of the gun deaths are from suicide.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of deaths, gun violence from intimate partner violence. And so I think if we can really get to the roots at what is really causing some of these things in terms from a trauma-informed perspective, I think we can really make some progress in addressing all forms of gun violence. And I think that's particularly relevant for the Portland metro area and the state of Oregon. And you look at those numbers, like, for example, I think the data I last saw, most recently, the most recent five-year period, I think there is something around 1,800 deaths over 5 years from suicide in Oregon, and about 250 from homicide. So the numbers are, 2/3 of deaths nationally are from suicide, and about 1/3 are from homicide, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, of course, you look at specific age demographics by breaking them down by race and ethnicity, you'll see that homicide rates are disproportionately high for low-income African Americans, whereas suicide rates are ridiculously high for 55 and older white men. And so we have two different, at least two different conversations. Plus, you throw intimate partner violence on domestic violence in there. We have three separate conversations about how to address gun violence.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that, health is political. And all these separate conversations, they're going to be politicized, and people are going to feel certain ways about them. And we haven't even talked about the availability of guns and the manufacturing of guns and everything, right? So these are all at least four conversations that are brought in and about themselves, right? But something that they all have in common, I would argue in many ways, is pain, trauma. And if we can start there and show that regardless of how gun violence has affected you, what form of gun violence has affected you, that we can have this conversation and kind of come together to understand that, hey, we're all kind of experiencing or dealing with similar things. They might not be the same thing, but can we acknowledge that we also have one overlapping thing that is pain, that is suffering, and it's a gun.
I think interesting what you're saying, because as I'm listening, I think one of the things, and I say this as it relates particularly to communities of color, as like you said, we have a spectrum of pockets of where this is, and because and when something is politicized, imagery becomes vital to politicization. And we are as African Americans, and I speak of African American Latino men particularly, we have become those who have been beholden to being the gatekeepers of this identity. And I think that really drives the public safety narrative of how it pans out. By that, this is what I mean. If you think, even as we kind of started out framing this discussion, we look gangs, we look young, we looked of color. We didn't, as he said, we didn't look at interpersonal violence, which, because we can all think of Family Network, BET, they have shows purely built on men and women killing each other with gun violence. So there's a large segment with that. We have a plethora of shows talking about white men feeling disenfranchised in the trials of that. They are not promoted to be the gatekeepers of the identity. We don't attach the identity of gun violence to them. And as you said, just numerically, they're disproportionately far ahead. So what we have to look at is the imagery of gun violence, and also how we as a community perpetuate the passing of that legacy on amongst each other by how we identify our role in. We don't have a gun violence problem. We have an interpersonal communication problem where guns end up being the medium of how we destroy each other. America has a gun violence problem. You know, we never had a slavery problem. America had a slavery problem. We suffered from America's slavery problem. We're suffering from America's gun violence problem too, because again, it's being shaped, the image to be scared of, that you need to be safe from, is usually brown or black and male with tattoos between 18 and 30.
Okay.
But we need to look at, okay, if going back to what he said, the underlying thing, if we look at the pain created, and why, and asking that question, why are we not finding solutions to America's pain management problem?
Okay.
Because I think gun violence, if we really want to be honest, to the root, it's a pain management problem.
Okay, okay. But at the same time, you know, as I hear the conversation, I'm thinking, again, from an age factor aspect of it,
mm-hmm.
you know, you're getting ready to have this conference aspect of it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how do you get the older folks involved in the process? Because they were, that's not how they related to this issue of pain during that particular time. And all due respect, in a segregated community, mm-hmm. that was an issue. We had to deal with those issues. You had the fights, and Johnny was known by so-and-so and so-and-so.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we had local little gangs because of youth, you know, going to school or whatever. But that was no drive-by shootings during my time, during that particular time. Mm-hmm. You got me? And so we want these folks to, hopefully you'll be able to communicate to them, because they are the grandparents.
Yeah.
They are the grandparents. Mm-hmm. They should be inclusive of understanding what they're, because that's part of the solution. You got to get everybody at the table. That's basically what we're talking about. And we don't have a segregated community anymore. We just have an open community where you just have to go for what you know.
I agree.
You know what I'm saying? So
I would just like to go back to my original conversation. I think I think they did suffer because they have the diseases. That goes to the health issue. So if you look at that generation.
How did they define that when you say health?
Well, I think that because they weren't dealing with the pain and they weren't dealing with these issues, they may have been, I had an uncle who died with a knife, you know, his wife. It was that interpersonal thing, right,
mm-hmm.
when I was a little girl, and I remember that, right? So I think these things did go on in that generation. I think they didn't talk about it. That wasn't talked about in my family. But there's a lot of people in that time that had different diseases that I think came out of that situation, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think the reason why I take love as a posture, because I think the communication, like when you are in an elementary school, I think when the racism in there, you know, and you don't have the right teachers, I think all of that generates some of the pain. You can almost see it in a kindergarten class. You can see it in a first grade class. You know who the kids are going to have problems, right? We know this. So if we know these things, why aren't we doing something about it early, having more sports, more exercise, more people of color coming into these classrooms? That's why I think personally that it's the issue of communication and love. And I think it stops gangs of, I don't think a gang is just a gang out in the street. I think a gang could be the way that we run the church, the way that we run our groups. There's many ways we fence people out in our community and not have this full-blown love where people can get what they need from our community, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like all the generations are affected. I think the seniors are affected. I think the kids in college are affected. I think when we, when we cheat the kids on where the money goes, yeah, they're going to miss.
Okay.
So, yeah, they're going to do what they need to do to survive.
That's what I'm saying. We just need to educate. I'm just saying, you want them at this forum.
Yeah.
And they need to be a part of it. Because if you don't get them, make them a part of it, they won't attend.
Completely.
You know what I'm saying?
And I think, it's definitely a great point, because I think regardless of which form of gun violence we're talking about, if you're talking about interpersonal violence, gang violence, young people shooting, killing young people, parents, mm-hmm. you know, the victims of gun violence aren't just the people that get shot and die.
Yeah.
It's the survivors, too.
Yes,
they're dealing with things that they have mm-hmm. to come overcome and deal with, right? And so, you know, at least, like, for me, where I grew up at, teenagers get shot and killed, young adults get shot and killed, but it's their moms and their grandparents that are making the funeral arrangements,
mm-hmm.
right? There's definitely multiple generations that are affected. Mm-hmm. Their children are going to be affected as well, right? And
mm-hmm.
they're going to have that and embody that experience and that trauma mm-hmm. over their life, unless we figure out a way to address it, right?
Yeah.
So
I think you just hit a good point, because what you said is, with these individuals, when young men are killed, their moms and their sisters are making the funeral arrangements.
Mm-hmm.
I just ended the trial for my brother's murder. And what I will say is that the father's the brothers, the uncles are left to do this too. And I think as we have this conversation, as we look at the victims, as we look at the injured, as we look at those left to deal with the pieces, we have again been conditioned to think of this as the women. We don't look at the men who are left. And going back to my original discussion, those men without the literal words or the emotional capacity to process that grieving, and that's what we perpetuate. And again, so for me, it always becomes down to, are we, it, sometimes the really, the details are in the minutia, and it becomes our language and attitude and how we look at it as we look at transforming. We also have to transform how we perceive victims, because to a certain degree, we don't see men as victims of violence. We might see them as survivors. We might see them as perpetrators. We very see them as the victims who have to go on, who have to still raise kids, who have to still deal with their own demons, who have to process that and be whole. Because, and so I think when we look at this transformation, and again, for me, the issue of violence, once we become specific to a to any population, it becomes so myopic that we, again, forget to go upstream and look at, and like you say, take those steps back enough so that the aperture can open up and we can really see the picture. And also looking at, okay, because, you know, if we continue to have this dialogue about after the violence, but we eliminate the voice of black men or brown men or white men, we still don't get to that root ouch.
But your point that you made in regards to the separation of the black men and, as you say, et cetera, what happened to the family, the definition of the family? Back in my days, it was the family, meaning mom and dad was there. You got me? The black man was not left out. The family was there. So the hurt was the family and other families. But today, as you say, there's this separation.
And I think if you really look at that, let's be honest, the separation of black families was intentional. It was a calculated thing to achieve a targeted objective. With that said, it is what it is. So now that we have that reality to deal with, and I think too often as we look at discussions about what went wrong, we put, in my feeling, we give undue time to why isn't it like it used to be. And I always equate that to, if I'm on a sinking ship, I don't care if the guy who used to repair the boat did a great job. Right now, the hole is here. How do we fix it? And I think sometimes as we look at the conditions, we have disfranchised families. What are those root causes? How do we make that? How do we look at those to rebuild that? We look at what family is. And sometimes I think in a dynamic life, what family is changes. You know, I think sometimes when we look at, like if we look at, I don't like the term gang violence, if we look at interpersonal violence between young black men, what's lost is most of the components of vital, vibrant family structure are found within a system of friends, because it doesn't exist in family. So some, for a lot of our young men, the family structure isn't biological, but it has just as much impact. So a question along the way while we're doing this is, how do we take these attributes and get them back into the family? Or how do we take some of these values and incorporate that into the systems that young people or older people value? Because, again, gun violence is not an age-specific issue. And I think as we talk about this, as the more we talk about young people, we leave out all the rest of the spectrum, which impacts.
And family, I think, is a very... I like what you're saying in terms of that key. And that's why I keep pushing this piece when you're putting this forum on. You got to make sure you include that, because that is the base, so to speak. When you hear words about gentrification today, and no one could care less about it, and its impact, again, help impacting, all due respect, when you say gentrification in this town is black folks.
And there's, well, I got to challenge that one.
Well, I know that from your perspective. I'm just saying it's an opinion. I'm just saying from my perspective, in terms of what I was doing during those early days of trying to get homes or, you know, getting folks to get in houses and this, that, and the other, and even at the Observer, we even put that district together. It was the first district in the state in the history of Oregon.
Wow.
Where they voted, if you will, in the legislature, mm-hmm. so that we could have a district where we'd give an opportunity for blacks to get elected. Not a black district, but where the majority of them were. Now that's the area that's being gentrified now. See, and no one says anything about, let's keep that together. That was a purpose for doing that, to try to keep some sense of family and some, really, again, talking about health issues. All the other things that you're talking about. So I'm just throwing that on there because I'm looking at the viewing audience, mm-hmm. and I'm seeing the gram, yeah. as you say, those folks, how do you get them to come, see?
Yeah.
So we're okay, I like what we're talking about, mm-hmm. this is good.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. I think that is like, that's a great example. I think, as I mentioned before, like a lot of that what we're seeing in terms of, you know, gun violence is a symptom of, in many ways, symptom of something else that's going on, right? By the time it gets to gun violence, so many other things that had to happen,
Right.
or so many other opportunities that had to have been missing
right.
over an extended period of time, right? Sometimes maybe it's just a quick turnaround. Mm-hmm. Maybe, I don't know. But for the most part, you can systematically look at and predict who the victims of gun violence are going to be. Based on, you know, for example, like if it's Baltimore or Detroit or some of these other cities or Oakland, East Oakland, West Oakland, the history of incarceration, the consequences of segregation and the lack of education and job opportunities.
Yes.
The breakdown, the deliberate, in many ways, breakdown through policies that are over-prosecuting, over-criminalizing certain offenses versus others, right? And so I think that in many ways you can look at a history of these policies and political decisions and practices that are, you know, they're shaping what's out there, right? And so if this is happening in Portland in the context of gentrification and everything like that, I think it just reflects something that's been going on historically and is happening all across the country. But I do think it's a fair point to say that we have to start with that conversation, we have to have that conversation, and we have to have continue this conversation that Roy was talking about with the understanding that there are multiple victims, not just the people that are losing their lives,
absolutely.
But the entire family networks, mm-hmm. right? And I think that in terms of the age, the numbers in Oregon don't lie. Most of the gun violence deaths are white men over the age of 55.
Yeah.
And so I think that there's multiple conversations that need to be have. And for each gun violence related outcome, there are separate social and political histories that will contribute to those outcomes. Mm-hmm. And so this forum is taking on a lot.
Yeah, this is important. We're gonna have about 50 minutes. Going on 50 seconds. I'm sorry.
Can we talk about where it's going to be?
Let's go on and identify where it's going to be. What
time?
Yeah,
that's what I want.
Going to be.
That's going to get the people there.
Keep them motivated to come on. Going on, Doc.
But
do your
where
thing.
Where is it?
Yeah. Tell
yeah.
Me
so
where you're
again,
who's
so,
going to be there? Who's going to be on the forum?
Yeah. So there's going to be a lot of great folks there from organizations that have been holding down the gun violence related work in Portland, Multnomah County, and the state of Oregon for a long time, long before I got here, long before I even thought about coming here. So there's people who have been on the ground, with the boots on the ground, making things happen and taking care of people and families in their communities for a long time. It'll be there. We're going to focus on hope and healing and transforming pain to power.
Okay.
There's going to be a youth breakout group as well.
So they'll be breaking out, talking.
Different breakout groups. Some will be focused on suicide-related gun violence, interpersonal violence, police shootings, related shootings, and then the youth breakout section that I'll focus on kind of training youth to use their power, their superpower to kind of tell their stories and reclaim their stories.
Fine. Thank you very much. We got about 1 second. But anyway, the bottom line is that it's going to get that address again.
Highland Christian Center,
Highland
7600
Christian.
Northeast
there you go.
Gleason
like
Street,
that.
Portland,
you're
Oregon.
You're going to be there? You're going to be there?
Yep.
Okay, fine.
10 a.m. to 3 p.m.
There you go. Good. Sounds good. Folks, thank you very much for being here. Appreciate it. Doc, again, welcome to Portland.
Thank you.
It's going to be really nice having you here. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Thank you, folks. Appreciate you. Enjoy. See you next week. Have a good one. Thanks, my friend.
Yes, sir.